Drybridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lymph-Link, Solving the Mysteries of Inflammation, Toxicity, and Breast Health Issues by Dr. Loretta T. Friedman. Read by Lisa S. Ware. Foreword. Food is medicine. After all, we are what we eat. When I met Dr. Loretta 15 years ago for some minor back pain, I knew she was a kindred spirit who believed this too. Besides both eating healthy, we think similarly enough about many other things. We are both committed to top quality service. Whether people dine at one of my restaurants or visit Dr. Loretta's office on Fifth Avenue, our job is to make people feel better. Who knew that a chef from rural France and a Manhattan lymph specialist could have so much in common? Growing up, meat and fish were expensive, so my family ate many vegetables at all our meals. Today, in my restaurants, I still believe in these types of dishes. Because, let's face it, no one needs to eat a 15-ounce steak. But Dr. Loretta taught me there is much more to good health than just eating well. The work I do is intense, keeping me on my feet for hours every day. Between creating in the kitchen and traveling internationally, my body can easily break down if I don't take care of it. Dr. Loretta showed me through my cell test results that, despite my clean diet, I still had inflammation and toxicity in my body. Now, doing lymph biologics every week and following Dr. Loretta's regime of supplements is part of taking care of myself. In fact, my whole family, the whole mishpacha, Dr. Loretta would say, trusts our health to her care. Just as I weigh every ingredient I use and write my recipes down very precisely, that's the German in me, I pay very close attention to everything she tells me to do. If she tells me I'm low on vitamin D, I boost up my vitamin D. I don't wait around until symptoms start. People are shocked when they discover my age, 65 at the writing of this book. Dr. Loretta always jokes with me and says, "You see how good you look, JG? That's all because of me." It's true. Between good food and Dr. Loretta, I'm set for life. If you listen to this book and follow her advice, I guarantee that you will be too. Jean-Georges von Grischkin. Introduction. Putting out the fire. We are a country of breast disease. Lumpy, bumpy, and tender breasts are considered a normal part of a woman's menstrual cycle. Teenage girls who get their periods for the first time become part of a collective complaining committee about cramps and nausea. These uncomfortable symptoms, we are told by our mothers and healthcare professionals, are normal and simply come with the territory of being a woman. Not so. The fact is that this pain and swelling are signs of toxicity in your body. What do I mean by toxicity? A toxin is medically defined as a poison, any substance that can cause structural or functional disturbance when taken into the body. Toxicity can come from any number of elements, including a hormonal imbalance, leaky gut syndrome, heavy metals in the bloodstream, dietary sensitivities, or chemicals in your food. This information is not the stuff they teach you in high school health class, nor is it what most Western physicians learn in medical school, where they're taught to look at human anatomy through a very small lens. During my many years as a surgical nurse, I was trained this way too. Even though I developed an excellent grasp of physiology, I hadn't yet learned to step back the way I do now and take a holistic approach to patients' health. We can't afford not to see the forest for the trees any longer. Because that forest, women's health, is on fire. The number of cases of breast and lymph-related diseases alone in women between the ages of 35 and 60 is alarming. If you include the vast number of deadly diseases like asthma, type 2 diabetes, lymphoma, and breast cancer, then we've got a national crisis in women's health on our hands. Breast cancer alone kills about 43,600 people per year and will affect about 1 in every 8 women in the U.S., making it the most common cancer among women. What do all of these conditions and diseases have in common? They are all linked to inflammation caused by toxicity. According to any medical dictionary, inflammation is typically defined as a localized protective response elicited by injury or destruction of tissues, which serves to destroy, dilute, or wall off both the injurious agent and the injured tissue. Naturally, many kinds of harmful toxins could lead to that protective inflammatory response. In 2017, Silent Spring Institute, a forerunner in women's health research, published the most thorough review of epidemiological research on breast cancer to date, indisputably linking toxicity levels to the disease. The Institute identified 296 chemicals found in common products, such as hair dye and pesticides, which can lead to increases in levels of hormones known to contribute to breast cancer. Fully 219 of those chemicals were newly identified as carcinogenic. Ruth Ann Rudell, director of the Institute and author of the study, concluded, "The way that chemicals are tested now, we really are missing breast-related effects. We have to do a much better job of testing for these effects when we test chemicals." Prior to this, in 2014, the Institute conducted a study that showed 17 types of chemicals that should be top targets for breast cancer prevention due to their risks when present in women's breast tissue. They included chemicals found in common substances such as gasoline, vehicle exhaust, flame retardants, stain-resistant textiles, paint removers, and even disinfection products and drinking water. If you are listening to this book, chances are you've suffered from at least one of the conditions I've mentioned so far. Maybe as a result of plastic surgery or a mastectomy, your lymph nodes have been compromised. Maybe you've been battling with your weight and insulin levels for some time. Chances are you've already been exposed to traditional Western practices such as lymph massage, water pills, hardcore prescription medications, or what I call rack 'em, stack 'em, and crack 'em chiropractic work to alleviate your symptoms. You've tried everything, but nothing seems to deliver permanent relief. You've lost money, time, and energy. Most importantly, you've lost hope. I know what this feels like, because a long time ago, I was there too. My own journey toward relief. Back in my early 20s, I was cruising through the Midtown Tunnel one night when a car in the next lane swerved into mine, causing me to smash my face into the steering wheel. I developed a severe temporomandibular joint dysfunction, TMJD, problem that didn't go away. TMJD is when a person experiences pain in the joints that act as a hinge for the jaw, connecting it to the rest of the skull and/or the muscles that control them. It's a widespread condition, affecting over 10 million people in the U.S., and one of the worst parts is that doctors often don't know the exact cause, attributing the pain to some combination of genetics, arthritis, injury, and teeth grinding. For 4 years, I walked around with jaw and neck pain and chronic headaches, popping Motrin pills like they were M&Ms until finally I had to see a gastroenterologist for an ulcerated stomach. I tried dental reconstructive surgery and a ton of different gizmos and gadgets to fix the problem, but nothing helped. Finally, one day, my girlfriend introduced me to her chiropractor, who had just begun to practice directional non-force technique chiropractic. After one adjustment, my world was officially rocked. For the first time in eons, my headache went away. Over the next few years, I received treatment while simultaneously studying the technique myself. I knew that I wanted to give others the hope that this therapy had given back to me, So I became one of only 150 directional non-force technique chiropractors in the country, practicing this unique method that guarantees lasting results in an average of 6 sessions. Getting to the heart of the matter. The Lymph-Link is more than just the title of this book. It is the answer to almost all systemic inflammatory issues, whether they are underlying or creating a great amount of discomfort. The state of your lymph is your body's best indication of overall health. Very few institutions promote breast health in this country, which is at the heart of lymph health for women. I'm here to tell you there are effective ways to take care of your breasts and general lymphatic health on an ongoing basis that most doctors might not even know about. Take, for example, the yearly prescribed mammogram. This holy grail of cancer detection can actually miss a lot. But a good thermography, which shows the neogenesis of new blood vessels in the body, can be pivotal in detecting cancer. The FDA even recommends it in addition to mammography for detecting breast cancer. And yet, many people have never even heard of it. Many doctors all over the country are misdiagnosing women left and right. Stacy was a 20-year-old college student who drove all the way from Ohio to Manhattan to see me for strange swelling in her neck, torso, and legs. Believe it or not, her hometown physician had told her she was probably just eating too much. To add insult to injury, he recommended that she also take a pregnancy test. When this poor young woman came into my office, I diagnosed her with systemic generalized lymphedema and started her on the lymph biologics protocol right away. Lymphedema is thought to affect as many as 250 million people around the world, and it can be caused by any sort of disruption to the functioning of the body's lymphatic system. Yet it didn't occur to this poor woman's doctor even to consider that it might have been what was behind her symptoms. After a week of regular sessions, the swelling in her body went down enough for her to drive home pain-free and with an earful for a doctor. Don't get me wrong. I wasn't born knowing how to diagnose and prescribe the way I do today. It took a lot of trial and error and even more active listening to find the common thread of toxicity in each patient's story. For example, I used to think my patients were retaining inflammation because their adrenals were compromised by stress and their cortisol levels were too high. Cortisol, after all, is the body's main stress hormone created by the adrenal system when we undergo stress. Of course, some of us experience more stress than others, and a system that is constantly producing cortisol can lead to serious health problems. But as time passed, I came to see that many of my patients actually had low-stress lifestyles and weren't necessarily anxious people. I also realized that the chiropractic adjustments I was making weren't sticking, and the inflammation wasn't going away. This led me to ask what was still feeding the inflammation. By posing a series of diet and environment-related questions and checking their cell health, I was able to find that the biggest problem was that their lymphatic systems were out of whack. And the biggest culprit in their poor lymph health was toxicity. Even Oregon Health and Science University cites cancer treatment as the most common cause of secondary lymphedema. That includes chemotherapy, the introduction of chemical treatments into the body to fight cancer. And as we know, when a chemical taken into the system does harm to the body, it is at that point considered a toxin. Time to bang the drum. I have been doing lymph biologics on my patients for more than 22 years, witnessing some of the best results you'll find for lymph-related conditions. The device I use in my office combines light and noble gases to create an electrostatic field that, when moved with the right technique and rhythm, improves lymphatic flow and accelerates detoxification of the tissues. In addition to lymph biologics, I also prescribe a regime of metabolic detoxification that includes diet change, supplements, and the removal of toxins from my patient's environment. Typically, my patients experience relief almost instantly, and, more importantly, their results last a long time, if not their entire lives. For years, whenever I talked to my patients about their toxicity levels, most of them looked at me as if I had six heads. I was telling them something that none of their physicians had even hinted at, that their cancers, autoimmune diseases, and the general accumulation of lymph fluid in their bodies was caused by a crazy amount of toxins in their lymphatic systems. After the 2014 Silent Spring Institute study confirmed what I already knew about the link between toxicity and breast disease by identifying household chemicals that could be risk factors for breast cancer, I started banging my drum very loudly. I reached out to places such as the Lymphatic Education Research Network, sending them information about lymph biologics and its success in treating lymph-related issues. I did the same thing with all of the hospitals that were offering alternative programs in the metropolitan area. Institutes such as Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, Weill Cornell Medicine, Memorial Sloan Kettering, and New York Presbyterian Hospital. I even contacted all of the top functional medicine doctors around. No one would give me the time of day, except the late Dr. Mitchell Gaynor and Dr. Sheldon Feldman. Dr. Gaynor took my phone call immediately and was interested in my lymph work and impressive results. At the time, I wasn't aware of how high on the totem pole in the oncology world he was, or that he was the one who introduced turmeric, B12, and CoQ10 to mitigate symptoms and enhance chemotherapy. Unfortunately, Dr. Gaynor passed away before we could establish a working partnership. Dr. Feldman and I met after I saw a patient of his who was in excruciating pain after months battling breast cancer. After one visit, her pain went from a 20 to 2 on a scale of 1 to 10. The only question this poor woman asked was, why? Why didn't anyone tell her about this treatment until now? I told her the reason was that nobody knew about it. I also encouraged her with the fact that she now had the opportunity to share with other pain surfers what she'd discovered about lymph biologics and to help educate her doctors about it. At the same time, I was seeing more and more patients displaying acute signs of toxicity that coincided with their breast and lymph diseases. I listened to their stories. I witnessed their pain. And most importantly, I asked the right questions to get to the bottom of their health issues. The truth is, I'm good at what I do, but I'm only as good as the tools at my disposal. I've cracked some of the toughest medical cases around. What I do is not rocket science, but it does take test results and time to approach each patient holistically. Unfortunately, many patients are hindered by limited health insurance plans. High deductibles and low flexible spending accounts are their biggest opposition to the basic human right to good health care. I decided a long time ago to bypass the middleman and go straight to the folks who needed to hear what I had to say. I started posting blogs and producing YouTube videos, educating my viewers and challenging them to take their health into their own hands. Turning over the rocks. Then the pandemic struck. If there's anything that COVID-19 has taught us, it's that toxicity is a real thing. It was one issue when elderly and obese people and other at-risk patients developed lethal cases. But when the younger generation started to get hit hard, I knew it was connected to their toxin levels. People in their 20s, 30s, and 40s who should have been able to weather the COVID-19 storm the best got much sicker than anyone had expected. In many cases, they died. Even athletes who were considered in optimum health, but who had been drinking mercury-treated sports drinks since they were kids, became vulnerable to death. In fact, Food and Chemical Toxicology even published a paper arguing that immune system degradation from multiple toxic stressors, chemical, physical, biological, psychosocial stressors, means that attribution of serious consequences from COVID-19 should be made to the virus toxic stressors nexus, and that, for long-term pandemic prevention, toxicology-based approaches should be given higher priority than virology-based approaches. The 7 international authors of the article came to the same conclusion that I had, namely that the most severe consequences from COVID-19 and influenza stem from a degraded or dysfunctional immune system and the exploitation of the degraded immune system by the virus. And what is the cause of that degraded or dysfunctional immune system? I am sure by now you have some idea. The authors blamed a combination of many toxic stressors, including lifestyle choices, treatments for other illnesses, biotoxins, social factors, and a long list of environmental factors, including chemicals found all around us, such as microplastics, heavy metals, pesticides, nanoparticle, fine particulate matter, and air pollution. The question isn't, am I toxic? It's, how toxic am I? This book will help you find the answer. As you listen to it, you will explore your own breast and lymph health and find better ways to detoxify and prevent disease. You will also discover alternative treatment methods for lymph-related ailments. Most of all, you will learn how taking charge of your own health is the only way to find lasting solutions. Everyone has the right to know how their body should be functioning, and the daily assault that toxins in our environment and diet are carrying out on our bodies. Traditional medicine doesn't turn over all the rocks. It's often based on vague systems, such as blood tests that miss the heart of the matter, and ignore the benefits of more nuanced tests for elements such as environmental sensitivities, single nucleotide polymorphisms, SNPs, the most common type of genetic variation, which occurs throughout all of our DNA, cell age, and more. Finally, I believe it's up to every person to find their own unique path toward health. My hope is that with this step-by-step guide and reference book, I will help you to do just that. Chapter 1. Lymph. The dirty little secret your doctor will never talk about. More than 10 million Americans have been diagnosed with lymphedema. That's more than the number of people with muscular dystrophy, Jerry's kids, ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, and AIDS combined. And I believe that tens of millions more suffer from the condition every day. And that's in this country alone. When the pandemic of 2020 hit, and people all over the world started calling me for telehealth appointments, I saw firsthand what I'd always suspected. Another global health crisis has been among us for decades, plaguing our immune, digestive, and circulatory systems. The pandemic of toxicity is even worse because no one can see it, so no one is talking about it. As my patients from Saudi Arabia, Scotland, Brazil, and many other countries have confirmed, people all over the world are fighting invisible toxins from our external environment and the foods we eat, the water we drink, and the air we breathe. What does the lymphatic system have to do with our body's toxicity levels and many common ailments? Everything. What are most medical providers doing about it? Very little, if anything. As you'll soon learn from this book, if you have lymphedema or lymphoma, then you have toxicity. The problem is, until a person's immune system is challenged, toxicity can go virtually undetected. I am convinced that the COVID-19 long haulers are experiencing prolonged symptoms of the virus even to this day because of their abnormal toxicity levels. Foggy brain, insomnia, redness and swollenness in the tips of their fingers and toes, skin issues, a lack of appetite, and a loss of the sense of smell and taste are only some of the symptoms that indicate high levels of toxicity. This is not a risk that we can dismiss lightly. As we have all learned from the news media over the past months, even being vaccinated against COVID-19 is not an absolute guarantee against developing the disease. And 25 to 33% of those who do come down with it develop long-haul COVID-19 symptoms in some form or other. What's more, that statistic stayed consistent, whether the patient in question developed a serious case requiring hospitalization or the lightest, barely detectable infection. Though fatigue and shortness of breath are the most common long-haul symptoms, researchers seem to agree that everyone reacts differently to the illness over the long term. And that's the optimistic view. One study showed that 24.9% of COVID-19 patients had at least one symptom a year after their symptoms began. Amid all the hullabaloo, media coverage often seems to overlook the fact that it's a virus that disproportionately affects women. Women, for example, are 1.4 times more likely to report fatigue or muscle weakness from it. We are 3 times as likely to have lung problems after 12 months, and twice as likely to report experiencing anxiety and depression. Clearly, COVID-19 is tightly bound up with the presence of toxic substances in the body with the breasts and lymphatic system. In the next chapter, I'll talk about common toxins in our food, water, and the air we breathe. For now, what's important to understand is that lymphedema and lymphoma are impossible to talk about without also discussing the issue of toxicity. But before we get into all of that, let me first introduce you to the lymphatic system itself. Lymph. What is it? Simply put, the lymphatic system is the body's superhighway disposal system for trash. Once your white blood cells work to eradicate infection and disease, the resulting debris travels through tissues and muscles via lymph fluid, contained in an intricate network of vessels. All throughout this network are bean-shaped structures called lymph nodes, where this debris is dumped. Altogether, your body has about 160 lymph nodes in the head and neck region, 300 in the trunk of the body, and hundreds more in the lower extremities. Depending on what type of waste is being deposited, your lymph nodes can become inflamed or irritated and react by swelling up and becoming hard. Alternatively, they can become extra tender and highly sensitive to touch. This type of reaction often happens in the breast tissue, which contains dozens of lymph nodes. Contrary to popular belief, lumpy, bumpy, and tender breasts are not a normal part of a woman's menstrual cycle, but a clear indicator of toxins in your lymphatic system. More on this in Chapter 9. There's nothing mysterious or sexy about the lymphatic system. It's simple. Next to every artery and every vein is a lymphatic vessel. You'll never read an article about it when you're waiting in line at the grocery store, nor will your doctor ever bring it up unless there's a problem. But don't mistake simple for insignificant. As you'll soon learn, the lymphatic system is one of your body's most powerful ways of clearing out toxins and maintaining good health. Yet, as I said, unless uncomfortable symptoms start to occur, most people don't even know it exists. In many cases, that's because they have been told by trusted sources that they should ignore what I consider to be a clear sign of lymph dysfunction. Even mainstream medical institutions, such as the Women's Clinic of Texas, have acknowledged the role of environmental toxins in causing breast lumps. Yet they continue not to encourage sufferers to seek remedies and eliminate these toxins from their systems. Listening to your lymphatic system. Not too long ago, Darlene, a software specialist in her 40s, came to see me because the right side of her jawbone was inexplicably swollen. She had already visited several medical practitioners, including a TMJ specialist, who, oddly enough, was the same one who treated me 35 years ago after that devastating car accident I told you about in the introduction. This specialist had given Darlene all kinds of bite plates and devices to alleviate her pain and swelling, but nothing worked. When I applied lymph biologics to her, More on this three-part oscillating light treatment in Chapter 7. I noticed that the lymphatic fluid in her face was moving around, but not draining. I've seen cases like this countless times. Patients arrive at my office desperate, having gone through several rounds of unnecessary medical and dental treatments for their misdiagnosed ailments. Sadly, this type of rigmarole is often unavoidable since most doctors are trained in only one area, and therefore can only see a patient's symptoms through that specific lens. You got pain in your jaw area? Then it must be caused by either A, B, or C, says Dr. So-and-so. That A, B, or C varies greatly, depending on which specialist you visit. Doctors may be looking under the hood, but they're only looking at certain parts. More importantly, most of them aren't paying attention to the quality of the fluids that are running through the pipes and valves. The stuff you can't see with the naked eye. Poor Darlene's experience was no exception. She was exhausted and feeling hopeless. We did a cell test in my office, as I do with every patient, which gave us immediate answers about what was really happening in her body on a cellular level. A cell test is also known as aging analysis. It works on either what we call the basal function of the cell, those that all cells share, or on special functions that only certain cells carry out. I look for effects in the function of the cell caused by certain substances. And as we all learned in school, if there is an effect, there has to be a cause. If the cells are reacting as we know they do when affected by certain toxic substances, then we know that those toxic substances are present in the body. As I expected, Darlene's root problem had nothing to do with structural misalignment, but rather with the fact that her toxicity levels were off the charts. If I'd told her 6 months earlier what I told her at her visit, that the swelling in her jaw was caused by a malfunction of her liver, she would have looked at me like I had two heads. But that day in my office, she was ready to hear anything that could provide some relief. I explained to Darlene that what was going on in her body was enterohepatic recirculation, EHRC, a fancy way of saying that her waste removal system was off. As I defined this term and started to teach her about the important waste removal processes that a healthy body performs on an ongoing basis, I watched her demeanor start to change and a glimmer of hope start to shine in her eyes. This moment of understanding, when a patient begins to comprehend the inner mechanisms of their own body, is a constant reminder of why I do the work I do. Most of the time, patients come to me with almost no knowledge of how their bodies are supposed to function. Most of my job, therefore, is to educate them. As the saying goes, knowledge is power. In my practice, more specifically, knowledge is the power to heal yourself. To understand how EHRC works, you need to know that the body has primarily two phases of waste removal. Phase one, when the liver releases through bile all of the toxins our bodies absorb. And phase two, when those toxins get removed through the urine and feces. Without getting too technical, for that you can read a medical journal, EHRC happens when phase two isn't working at full capacity. In Darlene's case, as waste kept recycling back to her liver, phase one needed to overcompensate by working even harder to break down the toxins. In essence, her liver was dumping more and more toxic debris, mostly heavy metals, into her system, while almost none of it was getting released out of her body. The result, no pun intended, and pardon my French, was a real expletive show. The heavy metals in her system were inflaming her lymph nodes, creating the uncomfortable swelling in her jaw. I first needed to make some adjustments to her neck, which had gotten completely out of alignment due to the pain her body was shifting to try to alleviate. Realignment was important to help the lymph fluid in her jaw start to flow properly again. But the real culprit was the level of heavy metals in her system. For that, she needed a regimen of heavy-duty antioxidants, such as liposomal, glutathione, and a clean, organic diet. After discussing her daily life, I learned that Darlene's stress level was high too, which wasn't helping. In addition to her demanding job, she exercised regularly and looked to be in good shape. With her productivity and physical fitness, no one would ever have guessed that she was so toxic and that her phase one and phase two liver functions were in the toilet. I started her on a regimen of ashwagandha and rhodiola with ginseng to support her adrenal glands. I also advised her to spend 15 minutes a day sitting in meditation before bedtime. Lastly, I talked to her about getting off the subway 2 stops earlier each day so she could get 20 minutes of cardio in on a regular basis. Taking a holistic approach to your lymphatic health. As you can see from this one example, getting to the bottom of a patient's health issues requires some detective work that most doctors do not have the time or resources for. Quite frankly, some doctors who may have the time and resources just don't care enough to track the clues. Instead, they choose from a handful of diagnoses and provide treatments that are, usually, benign enough not to create more damage. These treatments may or may not alleviate some symptoms, and they never deal with the source of trouble. Even in the mainstream world that doesn't jive with holistic approaches to healthcare, it's universally recognized that misdiagnosis is a serious and urgent problem in the healthcare world. By some estimates, misdiagnosis in hospitals alone kills 80,000 people per year. Just imagine what that number would look like if we added in deaths that were the result of misdiagnosis in the offices of primary care physicians or specialists, many of whom the patients should never have been referred to in the first place. Patients like you, who suffer from lymph issues, are especially vulnerable to incidences of misdiagnosis. For example, scientists have recently identified a disease called indolent T-cell lymphoproliferative disease, TLPD, of the gastrointestinal tract. That's a mouthful, but in simple terms, this disease causes lesions of the gastrointestinal tract and symptoms that, even to the trained eye, closely resemble that of non-Hodgkin lymphoma. As a result, doctors often begin treating the patient for cancer. Cancer treatments kill healthy cells in their effort to kill cancerous cells, which means that the misdiagnosis leads to innocent patients' healthy tissue being destroyed in an effort to fight a cancer that does not exist. What's more, indolent TLPD does not respond to cancer treatment, which means that those who have it will continue to suffer from their symptoms without relief if they are mistakenly treated for non-Hodgkin lymphoma instead. What does this all add up to? Misdiagnosis is a silent plague, and it's one that virtually nothing is being done about because most doctors don't even consider it to be a threat. After all, how can you realize the danger of something that you don't even think exists? That's right. While cancer misdiagnosis rates as a whole are at about 28%, a survey of doctors found that a 60.5% majority of them would estimate that misdiagnosis rate as somewhere between 0 and 10%. Of course, nobody likes to admit that they themselves are making mistakes. But doctors need to do it when the stakes involve human lives. And here's the kicker. The BMJ Quality and Safety Medical Journal has found that the most misdiagnosed cancer is, you guessed it, lymphoma. If that much misdiagnosis is going on where cancer is concerned, just imagine that amount that is happening involving non-cancerous lymph diseases, which doctors tend to treat less seriously than they do cancers. Helping a patient to take the reins of their health into their own hands is a holistic approach that medical school never talks about, but it is what my own practice is all about. Considering how many lymph-related medical problems get misdiagnosed each year, I believe that teaching people about the lymph link is a matter of life and death. That's why I wrote this book. Think of all the time, energy, and money people would save trying to find out what is wrong with them if their doctors did a simple cell test or urine analysis on their first visit to determine their toxicity levels and cellular functionality. Clearly, when it comes to medical detective work, we are missing the boat. But why? We live in a fast-paced consumer society that values quick, short-term results over long-term solutions and lifestyle changes that will truly make a difference. Consider all of the over-the-counter medications that are at our disposal at every pharmacy, deli, and truck stop. And that's not saying anything about the countless prescribed medications that keep pharmaceutical companies raking in millions of dollars every day. Conversely, learning to slow down, listen to clues your body is showing you, and learning new habits that promote health are not activities that stimulate the economy. They also hardly fit into our jam-packed schedules that allow very little room for relaxation. In Western culture, self-reflection and self-care are considered luxuries. Yet the rates for cancer and heart disease, conditions both caused by stress, are off the charts. Statistics predict that by 2035, 45% of people in the United States will suffer from some issue related to heart disease, and that the total number of cancer cases in the country will rise 49% from 2015 to 2050. And that's not just due to the aging of the population. A recent study showed that between 1973 and 2015, people between the ages of 15 and 39 showed a shocking 30% increase in cancer rate. Human biology has not changed in the past decade. Is it any wonder, given this information, that I look to the factors of increasing stress levels and of environmental toxins for an explanation? These are not warning signs we can ignore. Very often, lymphedema is an early warning sign that we are heading towards some of these more lethal conditions. It is the body's way of signaling that it is overloaded with stress and toxins, and is a clear cry for help. Most doctors are trained in practices that are aimed at quieting the noise so that patients can move on with their fast-paced lives, despite the deadly implications. I, on the other hand, teach my patients to slow down and listen to it. Lymphedema, the disease with 1,000 faces. If you look up the definition of lymphedema online, you'll find something like this: swelling in an arm or leg caused by a lymphatic system blockage. While this description is accurate, it doesn't tell the whole story. That's because lymphedema is a complex human disease that has been largely neglected by healthcare providers and government healthcare agencies. Only in the last decade has more effort been put into gaining insight into the disease. Yet, although progress has been made in fields such as lymphatic imaging and research into the connection between lymphedema, obesity, and other comorbidities, Western medicine still has a long way to go in understanding and teaching patients about lymphatic health. Adding to this lack of education in lymphatic health is the knee-jerk reaction doctors tend to have to grab the quickest fix to a problem, which is often a knife. Over the last decade, there has been a dramatic upsurge in surgical interventions for lymphedema patients. These include procedures designed to reduce the likelihood of lymphedema, debulking operations, and microsurgical interventions to correct impaired lymphatic vascular function. Still, while these procedures sound promising to patients who are desperate for relief, very little evidence exists that they are effective in the long term. Moreover, very little is understood by doctors about much less invasive, yet highly more effective modalities that almost never are offered to their patients as alternative options. There's an old saying, to a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Well,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.